Welcome, everyone, to the November edition of City Connector right here on City TV. I'm Lee Brogdon-Culberson of ProfessionalMojo.com, and I am thrilled to be with you. Fall is in the air, the holidays are right around the corner, and we have a full lineup of fabulousness for you. So stay tuned, and we'll be right back. Welcome back. Now, every day is a great day to live, work, and play right here in Douglasville and in Douglas County. But during the holidays, it is especially amazing because wonderful things happen as we give back. Joining me now is Judge Bo McLean. Welcome, Judge.
Welcome. Thank you.
Glad to have you. And we're going to be talking about one of those very exciting things that is really an ambitious undertaking and will make a huge difference in the lives of potentially thousands of children, and that's Operation Christmas Douglas County.
That's right.
So give me a little bit of an overview about how this got started and what it is.
Well, it got started in June of this year. Someone that I know decided to give our ministry about 5,700 Christmas presents, toys, and it birthed an idea. And the idea was, why don't we come together as a community and provide Christmas to all of our needy children in Douglas County as a community-wide outreach, instead of what we've done in the past, which is great. A lot of individual churches and ministries help needy families out at Christmas. But the idea was, let's come together and take care of everybody.
So really, you're leveraging what you had donated plus what other organizations are doing to make it something big and amazing.
That's exactly right. And once the idea was birthed, we tried to figure out, well, how do we determine who should receive, who should not receive? How do we reach the largest number of children? And the school system immediately came to mind. We have 16,406 children in the Douglas County schools on free or reduced price meals, which is a group of kids that we can reach out and touch and give them information about how they can receive for Christmas. So we're going to issue a golden ticket.
Very Willy Wonka-ish.
Very much so.
I like that. Get the golden ticket, get to turn it in.
Exactly. We're going to issue a golden ticket through the school system to every one of those children, and the ticket will direct each child and their family to multiple venues throughout the county, multiple churches, the sheriff's office, courthouse, fire department, other locations, where they will exchange their ticket for new unwrapped Christmas presents.
What an amazing thing for all of those kids. Now, it sounds to me like this is the first time that you've done this. Started in June. What was it like trying to pull all these organizations together? It seems like you've done a lot in a very short period of time.
Well, it is a major undertaking, but God is helping us every step of the way. We're getting a lot of cooperation and a lot of buy-in from the local church community. Baptist churches, Presbyterian churches, Methodist churches, Lutheran churches, Catholic churches, Assemblies of God, a very diverse group of congregations, businesses, civic clubs are all excited by the idea of reaching almost all the kids and doing it as a joint community project. We can do a lot more together in Douglas County than we can separately.
It's amazing that you're going to be leveraging all of that. Now, so do you guys match the gifts? Is that what happens? You match the gifts off with the child? What happens if it's a girl? How do they get a girl gift? How does all that kind of work?
Great question. The school system has provided us basic demographics. In other words, we have data from the school system that tells us the ages of all the children on free and reduced price meals and their sex.
Okay.
So we have this many 5-year-olds and this many 10-year-olds and this many 12-year-old boys, this many 16-year-old girls. And so what we're doing is matching age-appropriate gifts to each child as we gather the abundance we're going to have for them on December 19th, which is our big giveaway date.
Wonderful. Now, what do you need from the community? I'm sure people are listening. I know you have a lot of organizations involved, but how could we as citizens get involved in Operation Christmas Douglas County?
Well, we're going to start dropping toy donation boxes with our logo, which if I can hold this up so the cameraman can see it. This is the Operation Christmas logo that's been designed by Amalgamated Pixels, which is one of our partners. And we're going to be dropping toy donation boxes at multiple churches throughout the community starting this week, as well as multiple businesses and other venues. So we'd encourage you to contact your church to see if you can help your church distribute. We'd encourage you to contact us directly. You can reach us on Facebook at The Elf Squad, D.C.
The Elf Squad. I love it.
We are The Elf Squad, Lee. And the biggest needs we have at this point are volunteers to help us sort and distribute the gifts. And we need more gifts so we can reach all of the needy children in Douglas County, Georgia.
Now, some people might not have time to go out and get a gift or might not be comfortable. I would think that you probably take tax-deductible donations as well.
Well, judges are not allowed to solicit financial donations, but so I can't really speak on that. But what we're trying to do is the biggest outreach in the history of Douglas County to needy families. If I can share another statistic with you, according to the census, there's 11,501 children living in poverty in Douglas County. The target number we intend to reach is 5,000 more. So while we can't guarantee that we'll reach every single needy child in Douglas County, we're going to reach more than have ever been reached in the history of this community. And I believe we're going to make this happen this year. And God willing, if we do, I'm ready to do it next year.
That's wonderful. And again, that day is going to be December 19th.
December 19th, and one other encouraging detail that I can give you some breaking news right now.
I love it.
Toys for Tots has officially agreed to partner with Operation Christmas Douglas County, and they're going to be providing a very large number of gifts for our kids, and we are going to be the official authorized Toys for Tots, United States Marine Corps distributor
Wonderful.
For Douglas County, Georgia.
Well, congratulations on that, and thank you so much to them for stepping up and doing that. If for folks who are listening in, again, go on out to the Elf Squad DC on Facebook. Get involved. I'm sure if you're involved in a church organization, you probably can make a tax-deductible donation to your church if they're involved in this. And Judge McClain, you get the last word. I like to do that with the guests here. So what's the last thing you want to leave with our folks for Operation Christmas Douglas County? What's our takeaway?
Merry Christmas. And God bless us, everyone in Douglas County, Georgia.
Wonderful. Look for all of that. It's a wonderful, wonderful opportunity for you. Thanks so much. Come back and join us again soon.
Thank you, Lee.
All right, we're going to hop on out to the community calendar, and we'll be right back. So stay tuned.
Welcome to this month's interactive community calendar. I'm Kelly Hunter with the City of Douglasville, and joining me today is Whitney from the Chamber. Whitney, welcome with us.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about what you do at the Chamber, because you're new with this, with your position there.
I am. I came on board about 2 months ago, and I'm the communications coordinator, and I send out all of our emails and work with our director of communications and community affairs for all of our marketing material.
All righty, and you have found out quickly, I bet, how busy our chamber is in the community.
Yes, we are very, very busy, and it keeps us on our toes.
All righty. Well, who do we have here between us representing an organization today?
We have James and his friend from Strides Horse Park. Absolutely. And why don't y'all tell us about what's all going on with y'all?
Well, again, my name is James Chandler. I'm one of the job coaches here with Strides Horse Park.
And Raphael.
Hello. My name is Raphael Fauch, founder of the Strike Horse Park.
And basically what we do is we just help find employment for those that have disabilities. We also offer supportive employment and job readiness training. And we're here located in Douglasville at the Jesse Davis Park. That's where we do our training at, between the hours of 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. Monday through Friday.
Okay. Jesse Davis is one of the parks there that the city operates. And you were telling me beforehand as we were talking that one of the things you're looking for is for some sponsors, maybe churches, organizations
Absolutely.
That could use the services of your clients.
Absolutely. Mayor Percy is actually backing our program to bring jobs into our community. So we have a few companies and nonprofit organizations that support us. They allow us to come in and do volunteer work. So we're just really requesting the services and the community to help better our community and just let us move forward and progress. Mm-hmm.
Very cool. Yeah. And if somebody is looking to get in touch with your organization, what's the best way?
Social media. We're on all social media outlets, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and just look us up, Strides Horse Park, and just reach out and we'll be right back in contact with you all.
Yeah. Sounds great. Well, thanks for introducing your organization to us.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you, Raphael, for being with us today.
You're welcome.
All righty.
Take care. It was a pleasure.
Thanks, gentlemen.
All right. Up next, we have Davina Hill from the Cultural Arts Council.
All righty. And Davina is no stranger.
She is
with
not.
Us here.
She's a familiar face.
And I'm surprised she's here today because just this last weekend, they had one of your largest events of the
yes.
seasons, right?
I'm telling you, it's got to be the community's biggest block party. My goodness, we had lots of people having fun with chili.
And I heard it was only a standing room only because you couldn't move. It was so packed on the plaza.
That's right.
Good thing.
Very good thing. We had fun.
Well, tell us what the CAC has coming up in the month of November and December.
And no rest after chili cook-off. We're right into our next exhibit, which will be November 1st through Thanksgiving, all about texture, with Matt Bolton and Susan Lentz. Susan does the actual embroidery. Matthew does artwork that has so much texture it looks like fabric. So we're really excited to see that. And the reception is going to be on the 8th. I don't have my notes, too many. Sunday, November 8th from 3 to 5, and Studio V33 is hosting.
Well, very good.
Sounds like a lot of fun.
It does, yeah. Doesn't it? And the cultural arts is always a great opportunity for people to just join in with the local community. You offer a lot of free events.
Yep.
And so if you're looking for something to do with family and friends,
well, the family and friends come out for the next exhibit time because that's the holiday design card competition, December 1 through 17, that the students in the public schools have designed. The cards are now under production, the winning ones. Yes. We produce them and sell them for people to use for holiday cards. And that's always a packed exhibit and reception.
So it sounds like,
like a full-packed holiday season.
It does. Y'all are going to be busy at the CAC still.
And then we have our gala on November 14th.
Wow.
And we round out the year on December 20th with Kwanzaa being celebrated by our DC connections. And then hopefully we wrap it down and we'll see you back in January to talk about all the 2016 activities we have going.
Sounds great.
Well, Douglas County is very busy. Mm-hmm. Cultural arts, you're accustomed to it as well with your busy schedule.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for what you offer for our community.
Thank you for letting us share it with everybody so they know.
All right. Thanks, Davina. Appreciate it.
Okay.
All right. Well, Whitney, this is where we get to tell everyone how they can promote, I guess, their business and organization. And one thing that we do here is between our interviews on the City Connector, that's the last Tuesday of every month, is offer the interactive community calendar.
Right.
So if you have an organization, something that we'd like to promote, come visit us here about 11:30, that last Tuesday of the month, Arbor Place Mall.
Right. We'd love to hear from you.
All righty. Thanks for joining me today.
No
we'll
problem.
Be back with another segment
yes,
in just a
we
bit.
We will.
More City Connector.
Well, hey, and welcome back to this edition of City Connector. Now, I have to be honest for a second, and this makes everybody around me nervous, but I love it when the city of Douglasville, we have a little something-something that maybe other cities don't have. And we're going to talk right now to Assistant City Manager Marcia Hampton. Welcome.
Thank you.
Now, they may have assistant city managers and city managers, but you have something very special, and I don't want you to be modest about
okay.
it. It's a pretty amazing credential.
Yeah.
You were just awarded something from the ICCMA, and very few city managers, assistant city managers in the state of Georgia have this.
Right.
So tell us about it.
Well, ICCMA is the International City County Managers Association. So it's a global association of made up of several thousand managers, and they could either be city managers, county managers primarily, or even some department directors, but primarily they all work in local government.
Okay.
And they have a credentialed manager program. And basically what that means is they give managers an opportunity to test on all of the disciplines associated with city management. It's very different from what people may think of as a master's in public administration,
right,
where you kind of understand the principles of managing public administration. This actually gets to the technical components of managing a local government.
So where the other part of that, I mean, how those graduate degrees sometimes are a little bit more intellectually or philosophically focused.
Correct.
This really is the application of what you're doing day in and day out at the citizen level.
Exactly. It gets into every discipline, regardless if you're local government actually manages that discipline or not. For instance, the city of Douglasville, we don't manage our own utilities, but there are several cities and counties throughout the state of Georgia that have their own electric systems, our own water departments. We just don't happen to have ours, and there are parts of the test that actually test you on the management of those disciplines. So it could range from financial, public infrastructure, parks and recreation, human resources. So it's about 200 questions on the test.
Wow. So you've studied for this for some time.
Yeah.
Obviously, you have to be in the position. You have to have the relevant experience.
Correct. You have to either have a, of course, you have to have an undergraduate degree. So you can substitute your master's for years of experience if you have a graduate degree. But you have to, at a minimum, be in a senior level management position for 7 years. So I did have both. So it allowed me to be able to go forward and test for it. And if I didn't meet all those qualifications, they would consider me a candidate. But since I did and I met the test, I was able to be presented to the board for official vote for me to be a credential manager.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank
you. So, but I tell you what, though, not many people decide to go this route. You're one of what, 13?
There are 13% of women across the world who are local government managers. So typically wherever I go, I'm in the minority. And typically you don't really have a lot of younger managers. And when I say younger, typically a government manager is 55 or older.
Right.
They did talk a lot about the recent conference that I went to, just the struggle to try to get the younger generation engaged in public work at all. So on any level.
Right.
So, and then when you start talking about public, you know, administration and public management, it's a little bit different. And throughout the state of Georgia, I represent 26 credentialed managers. So there are 26 of us out of 500 cities in Georgia.
Well, again, I'm thrilled. And is it wrong of me to be selfish that I'm so happy the city of Douglasville has this right here? I am. I'm thrilled.
Yeah.
I'm thrilled. Okay, great. So I'll tell you what does it mean for us as a city and as citizens having you with this credential now?
I think that overall, when you are a local government, and regardless if it's in a city management position or any of our other positions, when you have a staff member that is credentialed and recognized across the state and across the really the nation in their field, that says something that folks can look at you and say, okay, they have their act together. They actually know exactly what it is that they're doing. You as the citizens, as well as the elected officials, can be on sound footing, understand that not only does your manager meet the educational requirements that are required for the job, but now they've taken it a step further, and now they can really meet the technical components along with what they do day to day.
And you know, as a citizen on the outside looking in at that, it really shows to me a level of commitment to being in public service and a commitment to the city and a commitment to us as citizens that I think is very comforting.
Yeah.
You know, it says to me, hey, you know what, that she cares about what's going on in the community. I'm sure you did anyway, but to have that put it into it and to work at it, so it's great.
Yeah, and public administration is one of those fields, and it's very, even if you cross over into nonprofit, you really have to have the spirit to do it. You know, some people joke and make the comment it's a thankless job. I wouldn't necessarily say that. I would say that you do get the thanks when you look around and people appreciate the services that you're working to help facilitate.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can find reward in that, find rewarding helping to build a quality of life for individuals, then public administration is the place to be.
That is well said.
Yeah.
Well said, Marcia. Now, there are some changes going on in the city of Douglasville as well. Many of us may have read about it, heard about it, listened to someone talk about it. Right. So share with us a little bit about what's happening over the next few months between now and the end of the year and how you'll be involved in that.
Well, most folks, I've been with the city, I started in August, I started my 13th year. So most folks kind of know me in the role of community development. That's where I've spent the majority of my time at the city. But 2 years ago, I was appointed assistant city manager, knowing that our current city manager would at some point announce his retirement.
Right.
Well, he did that earlier this year. So in December, he will be retiring. Most recently, the city council took action to empower the role of the city, assistant city manager to have the exact same powers as the city manager to allow for the both of us to be able to work through that transition so that as he retires, as he goes on and does other things and leaves
plays
all
golf,
of us, exactly, leaves all of us behind,
do.
We're not left in a lurch. There is still someone working in that capacity to be able to manage the role of city manager while he retires on us.
Right. So it'll be seamless. We won't know any difference in terms of the city and our services and what our expectations are as citizens.
No. He and I have worked together very well the last couple years. He's actually took some vacation, which for those who know Bill Osborne know that he doesn't really take a lot of vacation, but he recently took some extended vacation. So folks probably didn't even know that.
He knew you could handle it.
Yeah.
He knew you could handle it. Yeah. All right. Well, wonderful. And you said by about the end of the year, he'll be
his
golf outing?
His last official day is December 4th. So for those who know Bill and want to wish him well, he's at City Hall. So he does plan on taking some more time off. So call him up. I think he'd appreciate hearing the well wishes. Anybody who spent 25 years in local government, that's well worth the time. It's a very unique type of career. So someone who can stay in it that long should be applauded.
We will do that. Yeah. Congratulations on the retirement. Congratulations to you on your certification.
Thank you.
And thanks so much for coming on City Connector and filling us in.
Thank you for having me.
I'm sure I'll see you again.
All right.
All right, take care. We're going to go on out, listen to some wonderful music, and we'll be back, so stay tuned.
Through all kinds of weather.
This edition of City Connector. You're hearing about all the wonderful things happening in and around the city of Douglasville, Douglas County, and our entire community. Joining me at the table now, I have Bob Carpenter and Ada Green Harris of the Douglas County Lions Club. Welcome you two.
Thank you.
Is your first time on the show?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Well, we appreciate you joining us and telling us all about the great things the Lion Clubs do, because they do a lot of things locally, nationally, and internationally. So we're going to start at the local level. Ada, tell us a little bit about first when you guys meet and then what it is that you're doing locally.
Okay, well, we meet the first Wednesday and the third Thursday at Logan's Roadhouse. The Wednesday is at noon and the Thursday is at 6 p.m. But I wanted to tell you that Douglas County Lions Club was chartered in 2009. Before that, there was a Douglasville Lions Club from the 70s. My father was the president in 75, and now I'm the president in 15.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Carrying on the service.
Yes.
Right, in the family.
Yes. So our main focus is vision services. Mm-hmm. And last year, our Lions year is from July 1st to June 30th, and we had 16 service activities, and we served 400 people in Douglas County, with eye screenings and vision testing and also giving them glasses. So the International has a challenge called the Centennial Service Challenge, where they want us to do four different categories of service. And this year, we've already accomplished that. Just in September, October, we have the the vision category, mm-hmm. where we had vision testings at Centennial, September Saturdays.
Right.
Where we had vision screenings for all ages. We had the youth category where we had vision screenings at Brighton Academy for the children. The hunger category, we donated funds to Action Ministries through Bank of North Georgia. And the final one was environmental, where we participated in Keep Douglasville Beautiful recycling event, and we collected glasses. Those glasses are recycled throughout the whole world.
I think for anyone who maybe knows a little bit about the Lions Club and Lions Club International, they know that vision and sight has long been really part of your mission statement and what you do both locally, nationally, and internationally. So First, thank you for doing that for the community. I think that sight is one of those things that we can never take for granted. And you don't realize how important it is until something happens. Mm-hmm. So people who are involved in the club, you also, I'm sure, would take new members who might want to be involved in these types of activities as well, correct?
Oh, yes.
Okay, wonderful. I know it takes a lot of folks to put those types of events on. Now, Lions Club International has been around since 1917, and sight, like I said, has long been a portion of their mission. So, Bob, tell us a little bit about how what you're doing here locally kind of moves up the ladder nationally and internationally.
Well, I'll give you a little history of Lions Club. 1917, Melvin Jones, businessman in Chicago, a member of a group that kind of had focus on businesses, challenged the group, what can we do with the talent we have to improve our community? And so they brought in groups from other parts of the country, and that's how Lions Club was developed. In 1925 or 1920, we actually went to Canada. 1927, went to Mexico, so we became international.
Right.
Through the 50s and 60s, we had enormous growth that put us into Europe, Africa, Asia market, and that today is where we have our 1.4 million members plus in 46,000 clubs throughout the world plus.
Huge service organization. I don't
yes.
want you to skip the
We are the largest service organization in the world.
And I don't want you to skip the Helen Keller part. The Helen Keller part.
Yes, in 1925, Helen Keller actually addressed our convention in Cedar Point, Ohio, and she challenged the group at that point to become Knights for the Blind, Crusaders Against Darkness. And that is when the Lions Club International took on the focus of the visually impaired and the blind. And that's where we have come to this day, doing all kinds of sight or vision screenings, helping families who do not have the means to be able to have going and have testing, having glasses, etc. Yes.
So thank you for not skipping that, because for those of you maybe who have heard about Lions Club before and knew that you were very involved in vision, they may not have known that it came from Helen Keller addressing that group. That's a very long and rich history, so thank you for sharing that. So tell us more, though. There are some other initiatives that you guys are involved in.
Well, we got Sight First. Sight First was developed in 1990 and raised almost $400 million to be able to have an initiative to find the cause for blindness. In cataract, you've got glaucoma, you've got river blindness, and the Lions Clubs throughout the world and international are really a part of that in trying to overcome the problems that families have when they have the visually impaired children or even grown-ups. And in fact, in 1968, the Lions Club International developed the foundation. The foundation throughout the world sends money to Lions Clubs in certain areas to help the communities in their humanitarian efforts. And to give you an idea, $100,000 was actually sent to Michigan for the assistance in the leader dogs for the blind in renovating their training facility.
Wow.
The Lions Club International is very deep in working with the leader dogs for the blind. It's one of our efforts.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
So, and I would assume that that kind of information then you bring back to the local clubs and you share that here as well.
Yes.
What are some of the events that you hold besides the vision screenings that you hold locally that helps you raise funds?
Oh, we have a yard sale every year at Bank of North Georgia where people donate items and then people come buy them, and we use that for our fundraising events. We also sell brooms. A lot of people know about the Lions Club brooms. They're very nicely made and everybody loves them.
Actually, I didn't know about that.
Oh, okay.
I thought you were making some sort of Halloween reference for me about getting the broom. Wait a second. All right.
I am on your broom.
I did not know that. So
yes.
Really cool. So these are like well-made brooms.
Yes.
Everybody needs a good broom.
Right.
Okay. All right. Super, super.
Right.
What else do you do? Are those the two big things?
Those are the two big fundraisers.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Good. Mm-hmm. What were you going to say, Bob?
Well, I was just going to say also here in Georgia, we have the Georgia Lions Lighthouse Foundation. That particular foundation over in Chamblee has provided 567 surgeries, eye surgeries, at no cost to the family, as well as producing 25 different school systems that they work with, 127 schools that they work with. We've collected over 7,000 glasses that have been sent overseas to 35 different countries. And that's just the state of Georgia that has done that. That starts at the local level.
It does.
We collect glasses, we send them to the foundation, and they collect them and then send them overseas.
Such a wonderful and rich history of service. Now, I knew about the whole collecting the glasses and sending the glasses up. Now, for someone who might be listening out there and want more information, I know they can go out to LCI, that's Lions Club International, LCI.org, and get information. But they can always contact you guys, too,
sure.
Right at the local
yeah.
level. How can they do that?
Bob Carpenter, 770-949-4445. Call.
All right. And yeah, I like that. Just do it. And you would welcome having visitors or folks come and be a part of your local Lions Club, right?
Oh, yes. We would love for people to come out and serve with us.
Wonderful. All right. Ada, Bob, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having us.
Come back again and see us.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. So go ahead. Mark it on your calendar. Go out, visit the Lions Club, and do good. Doing good feels good. We'll be back in just a second. Stay tuned.
Welcome to this month's Interactive Community Calendar. I'm Kelly Hunter, joined with Whitney from the Chamber of Commerce, and we have the Interactive Community Calendar happening here.
Yes, a lot of community events that we hope you all can attend.
That's great. Who do we have between us here?
We have Colin Cash with the Courthouse, the Museum of History and Art. Why don't you tell us what's going on there?
Okay, sure. Well, the Old Courthouse Museum, for the first time ever, we are going to have a decorator Christmas show house. And this will be December 4th through 20th. Now, it won't be at the Old Courthouse. It will be in a location on Campbellton Street. We're not going to give out the address yet. So when you buy your ticket, you'll find out where the show house is.
So it's a mystery?
It is a mystery. But tickets will be $20. And each room is totally decorated out. It's going to be gorgeous.
Okay.
And the proceeds, of course, go to benefit the Old Courthouse. And we're also going to share some of the proceeds with a couple of other nonprofits. I believe Keep Douglasville Beautiful is going to be working with us. The Junior League Sustainers mm-hmm. Club is going to be working with us. So it'll be a fundraiser in addition to being a great holiday event.
A lot of people, we love to go look at decorations, especially we women, you know, and,
yes.
and see decoration ideas. That's what this will be for?
Yes, absolutely. Everything that's in the different decorator rooms will be available to purchase.
Okay.
After the show house event is over. You can't like buy it and then walk out with it. There'll also be a gallery and a gift shop. But now the great thing is, while all this is going on at the show house, at the Old Courthouse Museum during the same time period, we'll be doing daily lunches, like festively little packaged lunches, mm-hmm. and also there'll be a toy exhibit, a very special exhibit for the holidays.
All right, so you'll want to come by and see the exhibit. Now, the lunches, are they a purchase, and are those also those funds going toward these organizations as well?
Yes, the lunches will be $15 per person, and there'll be two seatings daily. So you can come at 11 a.m. or you can come at 1 p.m. And we'll have a menu. You'll have like three different choices that you can pick from. You can eat it there or you can take it with you. And then, of course, the gallery exhibit, the toy exhibit, is free. Absolutely free.
Great. So during that holiday season, tell us those dates again.
Yes.
December 4th through 20th.
Plan to come and enjoy the holiday season and all of the exhibits.
Yes,
there you go. Sounds like fun and festive.
Yes, yes. And all the tickets can be purchased at the Old Courthouse. We'll also be taking phone orders with credit cards. So you can visit us at CelebrateDouglasCounty.com and then click on the Douglas County Museum of History and Art.
All right. Sounds great. Colin, thank you for being and sharing all that information with us. And happy holiday season, right?
Yes, thank you. Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
Happy holidays.
All righty. Well, Whitney, this is always fun. And we always have a lot of other activities that are happening that usually the Chamber sponsors.
Right.
And I think you've got a few happening in your hand there.
We do.
Go over those with us?
All right. So we have our Bi-Local Bingo program, which will kick off on November 19th and end December 17th. And what it is we are partnering with local businesses to encourage people to buy local during this holiday season.
Definitely.
And so you'll get a little bingo card that you can pick up at any chamber event or at the chamber directly. And you'll go to the business that on the bingo card and you'll ask for a unique stamp or sticker or a mark from that store.
Okay.
And you have to get 18 out of the 24 squares to get into our drawing. Okay. And I think it's on December 17th. I'll double check that date, but we will have a drawing for a prize, door prizes.
So you're making not only shopping local, now you're making it fun. Because now you've got a game all about it. Right. Okay.
Who says shopping can't be fun, right?
That's right. The next item or next event?
Right. This is your chance to get into the local school system and to see what goes on behind the scenes. And so it's called Principal for a Day, and you can apply online at our website, douglascountygeorgia.com, and we will place you with one of the principals in our schools, and you can spend a half a day learning about how they run the school and what they do to make our students great.
And you know what? That's a great program. I've participated in that. It does give you the opportunity to get an up-close look at the school systems.
Definitely.
And the schools that maybe even your children are part of. Mm-hmm. And so I definitely would encourage anyone to sign up for that Principal for Day.
It's a great program.
Hey, Whitney, it has been fun having you as a special guest with me today as well.
It's been fun.
Yeah. Well, we'll be back with more City Connector. And if you want to promote your organization and or event, do it here with us the last Tuesday of every month, about 11:30 up in the food court by Chick-fil-A.
All right.
We'll be back.
See y'all soon.
Welcome back. I know that you have been enjoying Michaela Watson, and we're going to be hearing more from her in just a moment. But first, I want to remind you that we have loved having you with us on this edition of City Connector. You can see us on Channel 22 on Comcast. You can see us on Facebook. You can see us on YouTube. You can see us on Twitter. We're everywhere that you want us to be. I hope that you'll go out, you'll love it, you'll like it, you'll share it. I ask every time for you guys to do that, and I would love to hear from you and see your comments, because we appreciate you tuning in and finding out everything that's great right here in the city of Douglasville. So, with no further ado, let's talk a little bit to this lovely lady right here next to me, Michaela. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
So, tell me a little bit about, I love it. I heard you doing a sound check, and it was a great song, one that I remember. I'm a little bit older. So, what were some of your influences, and why do you choose the songs you choose?
I like to throw it back a little bit, where music was good all the time. The Beatles, Frank Sinatra, you know, Dolly Parton. I would love to just like hang out with her one day. And then I also like to rock out a little bit. So, you know, 90s alternative is really good. So Foo Fighters, Janis Joplin, she was amazing. I can really relate to her voice pretty well. So
very cool. And how long have you been doing this?
Singing, I don't actually remember as long as I've been talking.
Forever, your whole
forever.
Life.
I've been playing guitar since middle school, so a pretty long time.
Well, that is wonderful. Now, I know that you've done some gigs in the area. We can find out more about you on your Facebook page.
Yes, ma'am.
So how do they search that up?
Michaela Grace Watson on Facebook and YouTube. It's the same. And then Instagram, it's Michaela Grace 94.
Wonderful. So they can follow you there. And if they wanted to talk to you more about maybe an event or you singing for them, you would do that.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. All right. Wonderful. So before I close out and I walk off and let you sing, because I know that's what they really want, tell me, if you could meet any one of those people, any one of your influences, who would you want to spend time with and have a cup of coffee?
Ooh, tough question. So hard.
I know.
I'd probably love to just sit down with John Lennon one day and just have a cup of coffee.
Very cool. Yeah. All right, fair enough. Thanks for being on. We'll see you.
Thank you.
come